Hello and welcome to my EVE Online Beginner's Guide, Episode 3. In order to kill the enemies that we see on the overview, let's talk about a few things. First, the camera, then how do your weapons work, and then how do you move your ship. So let's start with the camera. You are currently in orbit camera mode. It means that your camera will always be centered around something, be it your ship or an enemy for instance. To turn your camera around, you can just hold the left mouse button and move your mouse around, and to turn your camera on its secondary axis, you can hold the right mouse button and move the mouse around. You can zoom in and out with the mouse wheel, and in the event that you do not have a mouse wheel, you can hold the left and right mouse button and then move your camera down and up to respectively zoom in and out. At the bottom of the screen, you can see that we are currently in orbit camera mode. But if we click on the button that is right above it, we will switch to tactical camera mode. This mode will automatically zoom out, but you can of course zoom back in, and you can of course have it behave much like the orbit camera. The difference is that, well, first you can zoom out much further away, and second, you can also detach your tactical camera from your main ship or from any other thing that it was centered on by holding right click, which will in that situation detach the camera and pan it around. This way you can have it behave much like the camera in Homeworld for instance. Another secondary effect of activating the tactical camera for the first time is that it will also enable your tactical overlay, by default at least. The tactical overlay can be enabled and disabled by using the button that is on the left of the tactical camera button, and it can also work in orbit camera mode. The tactical overlay will print a flat range indicator, which will help you in multiple ways, the most obvious one being the range indicator. As you can see right now, each enemy on screen has a small line that starts from itself and curves around to end up on the tactical overlay. It curves so that the range is preserved on a 2D plane. The dotted red circle indicates your targeting range. It will be useful later on, so we talk about that later. If you mouse over some of your equipped modules, which are, as a reminder, any item that you can equip on your ship, you may see a red or two red circles indicating its range on the tactical overlay. In the case of the mining laser, for instance, we have only one circle because the mining laser only has one type of range, but in the case of a turret, we have two circles, one for the optimal range and one for the falloff range, which we'll talk about right after. And finally, the tactical overlay also prints small blue arrows that start from any ship around and that basically represent their velocity vector, which are the speed and direction of their movement. You also have a secondary arrow near your own ship, but only if you left click on an enemy ship. You will see this secondary arrow represent the difference between your velocity vector and their velocity vector. You don't need to worry too much about these arrows right now, but they may come in handy later. And to wrap up on the camera modes, we also have the first person camera, which is utterly useless in combat situations. Now let's talk about your weapons. You currently have equipped one mining laser, which is not a weapon, but you also have one turret, which is indeed a weapon. By default, each shot you take with this weapon has a 100% chance of hitting the target. However, two factors will then decrease this chance of hitting, and these two factors are opposite of one another. The most obvious factor is range. As you saw earlier, when you moused over your weapon with the tactical overlay enabled, there were two circles around your ship that indicated the two ranges of your weapon, namely the optimal range and falloff range. If you fire on something that is inside your optimal range, then the chances of hitting that thing will not be decreased due to your range. If, however, you fire on something that is beyond your optimal range, then the chances of missing will increase according to your falloff range. It will be a gradient that starts at 0% added chances of missing when you are at the optimal range, and that continues to increase up until 50% added chances of missing if you are at your falloff range. So in other words, a weapon with a large falloff will be very tolerant if you go beyond the optimal range, while a weapon with a very short falloff will be very punishing if you go beyond the optimal range. So, as I said earlier, if you are firing on something that is below your optimal range, the chances of hitting will not be diminished by optimal range alone. However, there is another factor that will have an influence on your chances of hitting. This factor is the tracking speed of your turret. This is a concept that is pretty logical in itself, but is pretty rare to see in an MMORPG. So basically, your turret needs to turn around to keep track of the enemy that it is aiming at. Note that from a game mechanics perspective, the rotation of the ship on which the turrets are is not taken into account. It's just a ship-to-ship thing. So your turret has an angular velocity. It works not like the optimal range, but like the falloff range, in that as soon as the angular velocity between you and your target is not zero, the chances of missing will increase. So remember, the tracking speed is the attribute on your weapon, while the angular velocity is the relative angular speed between you and your target. Now, to better understand how to take advantage of it, I will need you to use your imagination. Picture, for instance, that you are in a car. You are moving at high speed on the highway. If you are trying to keep your eyes on another car that is next to you moving in the same direction and at the same speed, then you will not have to turn your head much to keep track of said car. And this despite the fact that you are both moving at very high speed. Still in the car, still in the highway, let's now try to keep your eyes locked on a mountain in the distance, for instance. Despite the fact that the mountain is not moving and that you are moving at very high speeds, the mountain will not move much from your perspective, because it is very far away. So as you can see, we have already two ways of reducing the angular velocity between you and your target. 1. Match its direction and speed. 2. Have the target be far away. On the contrary, if on the highway you try to have your eyes follow a tree that is right next to the highway, you will have to turn your head around very fast because the tree is very close and you are moving very fast. So clearly, range plays a role here because the further away the target is, the less its speed will have an impact on your angular velocity. And that's why the two factors, which are the range and the angular velocity, are both opposites of one another. So you will have to find a balance between the two. Now, one last example. Picture that you are standing on rail tracks with a train that is approaching right in front of you in a straight line. If you try to keep your eyes locked on the train, despite the train moving at very high speed and it being very, very close to you, you will not have to turn your head around because the train is moving exactly toward you. So clearly, it's not only the range and speed that are important, but also the direction of movement. And it's especially relevant for you as a new player, because in a small ship, if you were to fight against a large ship, your best bet would be to avoid its shots using your high angular velocity. And to do that, you need to move very close to it so that any movement you take is amplified by your close range and has a huge angular velocity. But while moving toward the enemy ship, do not move in a straight line or you will just reproduce the train situation I just described. So yeah, the angular velocity is pretty complicated. I advise you to bookmark this video in your web browser and come back to it once you have more mastery over your ship. And in the meantime, let's stick to keeping the target below the optimal range, but near its maximum. The angular velocity explanation, albeit technical, will be useful right now, because it will better help you understand the various movement options at your disposal during a fight. And that's a perfect segue to explain the various movement options available to you. So first, very basic but nonetheless very useful, is the double click in space. This orders your ship to move forward in the direction you just double clicked, indefinitely or at least until told otherwise. Just like any other movement order, it will be visually represented to you if you have the tactical overlay enabled. Instead of double clicking empty space, you can also double click something. It will issue an approach command. The difference is that the approach command will have your ship adjust its trajectory if the thing you are approaching is moving, for instance if it's an enemy. Of course, the approach command, just like any other movement command, is also available by using the selected item window, the radial menu, or the right-click menu. Another command, this time not accessible through a double-click, is the orbit command. The ship will approach the orbit target and will start circling around it, just like if it was in orbit. The difference is that the approach process will not be in a straight line toward the enemy, but instead slightly next to the enemy to start the orbit immediately, which is not a perfect way, but at least a better way to approach a bigger target when you still want to stay under their guns. Setting the orbit range using the right-click menu is pretty obvious, but using the radial menu, know that you have to drag the mouse away from the center of the radial menu to set a range, and this range will be sadly limited to 30 km, which in my opinion is bullshit, but never mind. If you want to use the selected item window, it is a bit harder to set up a custom range, but on the other hand, you can set up any orbit range you want, so that's a positive. To set up a custom range in the selected item window, right-click the orbit icon and select Set Default Orbit Range, and you can set your own orbit range to use for the selected item window. As you can see when mousing over our gun, the optimal range is 6 km. So in theory, you might want to set up an orbit of 6 km. However, know that because your ship has inertia, it may not be able to follow the exact orbit range you just set up. In fact, it will not. So in our situation, it's better to aim slightly below the actual optimal range of your gun, so that the enemy stays inside the optimal range despite any inertia issue we might run into. Of course, keep in mind that in EVE, just like in any other game, usually the ship with the fastest speed is the one that controls the range. So let's select an orbit of 5 km. If in the future you have weapons that have an optimal range that does not follow any right-click menu option, remember that you can also right-click on the selected item and set up a custom orbit range which will be remembered between play sessions. And finally, we have the keep at range command. The difference is that the ship will approach the enemy but will not circle around it. It will instead try to conserve the same distance to the enemy, but once it reaches that distance, it will stop moving, and it will certainly not move in a lateral way just like the orbit would. So the keep at range option is obviously less used, because once you reach the ideal range, it will leave your ship vulnerable, because your ship will usually tend to slow down and maybe stop moving, which is a very bad thing in EVE. However, it does have its upside. You see, since the angular velocity is relative between two ships, it means that if the enemy ship has an easier time hitting you, the reverse is also true. So in some situations, staying motionless, or at least having no transversal velocity and therefore no angular velocity, may actually be a good thing for your aim. And with that, we are now ready to approach the hostiles. Let's not approach blindly and instead approach from an angle which will put us at the optimal range of only one enemy, one which is isolated, without, during the approach process, triggering the other NPCs. We can also, in the meantime, start locking our targets, because for your modules to be able to be activated on something else than your own ship, you need to have a target lock. So to issue a target lock, simply right-click on a target and select the lock target option, or even better, and I highly recommend that you remember this shortcut, use the left control plus left-click on a target that you want to, well, target. You can also left-click while holding control on multiple targets to lock multiple targets at the same time, and the maximum amount of targets you can have is determined either by your ship's limitations or by your character's limitations, which are tied to his skills, whichever is the smallest. Then, to activate a module, left-click on the little target icon at the top right corner of your screen to make sure you have selected the proper target, and simply left-click on the weapon icon you want to use, in this case, the turret. You can also use the shortcuts F1 through F8 to use the first row of icons at the center bottom of your screen. Then it's Alt F1 through Alt F8 to use the second row, and then Ctrl F1 through Ctrl F8 to use the third row. As you can see, we are quickly chipping away at the various layers of hit points of the target. Then all that remains is a wreck, which we can then open to get some loot. However, we need to be at 2.5 kilometers from the wreck to be able to open it. So we can either issue an approach command followed by a open cargo command once we are at range, or we can directly use the open cargo command, which will automatically tell your ship to approach and then open the cargo. Once the cargo window is opened, you can simply use the loot all button to loot everything, but I do not recommend it for the first time because it gives very little feedback on what just happened. Much like everything else, you have multiple ways of doing the same thing. In this case, you can also click on the open cargo hold icon at the center at the bottom of the screen, put the two windows side by side, and drag and drop stuff from the wreck to your cargo hold window. In fact, you could have even dragged and dropped directly onto the open cargo hold icon, it would have worked as well. You can also use a Ctrl+A shortcut to select everything just like in your file system, or of course create a selection square and move multiple things around at the same time. Let's now kill any other NPC that remains near us, and then of course loot everything that remains. And while in the background I'm currently killing some NPCs, let's talk about something very important for both new players and veteran players alike, it is the show info window. You will soon have a wide variety of modules and trash in your cargo hold. To know which is which and to know which module does what, you can right-click on any item icon in your cargo hold and select the Show Info option. It will bring up a new window containing detailed information about what you just right-clicked. And the good thing is, it works on almost everything, even outside of course your cargo hold. It works on items, players, enemies, even some elements of the setting. And so it is basically the best way for you to get to know more stuff about what you are curious about. After killing and looting everyone around here, we are now ready to head for the station. Stations in Eve are very useful for you to repair your ship, buy stuff, sell stuff, change your ship's equipment, transfer stuff from your ship's inventory safely to the station's inventory, and so on and so forth. But as you may have noticed, solar systems are big. Big enough that it is not feasible for us to hope to travel inside them using our regular engines. Sure, we are going at about 300 meters a second, which is not bad, but it is nowhere near what we need to be able to travel inside a solar system. And that's why we have the warp command. The warp command is very useful to move around inside a solar system, and of course to escape combat. If you are in difficulty, do not hesitate to use the warp command to move away from the fight, which is called a warp off. Now, the warp command cannot be used in every situation. There are modules in the game that will stop you from warping. Luckily, in the tutorial, you will not encounter them, or at least not a lot. To warp somewhere, your ship will, once issued the command, align toward that direction and then warp. I use the word align very precisely in Eve, because in Eve, aligning has nothing to do with your visual ship's orientation. The server does not know your ship's orientation. It just knows your velocity vector, and then your client transcribes it into something that is visually logical for you. What I mean is that when I say align, what I actually mean is that to warp, the ship needs to be moving in the proper direction at least 75% of its maximum speed for the warp to engage, so it will not engage immediately. But at the same time, it also means that you can already pre-fill in advance the conditions for a warp to occur, so that once you click warp, you warp immediately. So in our situation, we can right-click on the station, which is the little square in the overview, and select align to. This will prompt our ship to move toward the direction of the station at maximum speed, and so once we click warp, for instance in the selected item window, we are able to initiate the warp instantly. And that's what being aligned means in EVE. It's not about your ship's visual orientation, it's about accelerating toward the proper direction at the proper speed. And therefore, another thing that might stop you from warping is a collision with something that stops you from being able to align properly. For instance, one of the asteroids around this place, which are pretty huge and usually a newbie trap when it comes to trying to align too close to them. If that happens to you, simply press Ctrl Space to stop your ship and therefore also cancel the warp command. Double click in space in a direction that will put you away from the asteroid, and then once you have traveled far enough, try to warp again. We will now enter warp, and about that, note that not all ships have the same warp speed. In fact, the starting ship is pretty slow for its size, but there are bigger ships that will be even slower than your starting ship. Once we arrive at the station, we can now right-click on the station itself and select the dock command. Your ship will now accelerate toward the station, and once it reaches 0 meters away from it, it will dock. Of course, 0 meters is not exactly against the station itself. There is some kind of sphere that is bigger than the station itself that represents the area in which you are considered technically at 0 meters away from the station. Alright, so we are now inside the station. We have new buttons that have appeared on the right side of the screen, and just like everything else in EVE, do not panic because some of those buttons are actually doing the same thing than some buttons on the left side. So again, less new buttons than you might think. We will continue to follow the opportunity system, which will tell us to change the equipment on our ship, but that is a big part of this video series and therefore will be covered in the next episode. In the meantime, thank you for watching this episode. Don't hesitate to leave me your feedback in the comment section down below. Again, don't hesitate also to share this content with your friends if you liked it. See you in the next episode, and of course, fly safe!